Just Between Us. We are back with another video. Let me address something up top. I did get filler in my lips and it is healing. So those are the bruises. No one punched me. Okay, moving on. We have a great video for you today. We are sponsored by our favorite sponsor,
HelloFresh!
HelloFresh cuts out stressful meal planning and prepping. You can enjoy cooking and get dinner on the table in just 30 minutes or even 20 minutes with their quick and easy option.
The packaging HelloFresh uses to ship your food is almost entirely made from recyclable and/or already recycled content.
With HelloFresh, produce gets to you faster than a grocery store and it arrives at peak freshness and flavor. HelloFresh is committed to making fresh, delicious food available now more than ever, and they have taken the extra steps to keep its employees and customers safe.
Easily change your delivery days or food preferences and skip a week whenever you want. So what did you make?
I made flautas, which are, I taste tested a little bit and they're
I thought we were gonna eat them together.
I know, I'm sorry, but they're a little spicy, which I love. So I made flautas with poblano peppers and onions and scallions and jack pepper cheese and sour cream.
I made roasted veggie farro bowls with marinated cranberries and salsa verde sunflower pepitas.
I love when you get to marinate the cranberries.
It's very exciting. Okay, so it's beautifully, my mom helped a lot. It's beautifully presented, but now I'm gonna mix it up for my first bite because underneath the lettuce is where all the action is with the farro.
Look at that crunch on the tortilla.
Mine is so good.
And it was so easy to make. It took me, like it said on the menu, like 30 minutes, but it took me less than that.
If you want to be as delighted with your food as we are, go to HelloFresh.com and use code JBU10 for 10 free meals, including free shipping.
Go to HelloFresh.com and use your code JBU10 to get 10 free meals across 4 boxes.
Mm. I feel nourished. Do we have to talk about the sad stuff now?
Yeah, we do. Because we've addressed it on the podcast, but we have not talked about it to the YouTube audience. And I know you wanted to, just because like, these are the people that have been here since day one. So
yeah.
Do you want to start with what happened? Do you want to start at the beginning?
Oh, I mean, I think people probably know what happened. In November, my fiance abruptly decided that he wanted out and, something was missing, and then he left me.
Okay. So, how do you feel about, like, the no explanation breakup, just in general?
Well, there was an explanation for him. Something was missing, and then
but
it wasn't.
But that's not a lot of, that doesn't leave you with a lot of explanation.
Well, to me, the explanation is that he was convinced that he didn't love me enough and that it wasn't the right relationship for him, so he left.
Okay. So what was your healing journey? What have you been doing?
Well, I'm still very much in the thick of it, but obviously I think that, you know, for me, I was like, oh gosh, I got to get the hell out of LA. Because, you know, it was quarantined and it was the apartment we shared and it was isolating. And so within a few days, I was able to fly home to New York, which was really good. Mm-hmm. And so I have just been holed up in Westchester County for 2 months.
Yeah. How have your parents been? What are the things that they've done that have been good for, like, helping you?
I mean, honestly, it's like just like the logistics of the help has been really helpful. So like, you know, that they like got me the plane ticket. They figured out where I needed to get my COVID test before I flew home. They, when I first got here, really did a lot with sugar because I didn't really feel like leaving the house. They, you know, they helped me with food. They pay for everything. They're just like, aww, you know, they're being really helpful and supportive. And then, you know, I think that like the emotional side of things, I feel like I've hopefully, you know, I've done somewhat of a good job of letting them know, like, what kind of support that I need, which is mostly just, like, this is terrible. You know, so, like, really learning now, like, when something this shocking and traumatic happens to you, to not immediately jump to, okay, you'll be fine, or, like, all right, so now, right, now what's next for your life? It's, like, I needed that validation that, like, what I'm going through is truly awful. There's so many tragic things that happen in the world, and I'm not one to, like, compare trauma or anything. And I think that that's a very dangerous thing to do. But one of the things that is really hard about this is that it was a choice. When someone passes away, most of the time that was not a choice, where this was someone I loved and wanted to spend my life with choosing to leave me. So I'm dealing with mm-hmm. both the grief of like, of him leaving and him not being in my life anymore and there being this like gaping hole, and then also the rejection aspect of it, and then also just the sheer shock aspect of it. And so it's a lot of moving parts. So like I have to attend to like kind of like three distinct wounds, if that makes sense.
right.
And so I think the first wound I had to deal with was like the shock of it, and like coming to terms with like, oh, this is real. Because I definitely at first was like, oh, well, he'll change his mind tomorrow, the next day, the next week, the next month. And obviously that's not the case. And so I think that initially I was in just such a state of complete shock. Then it was sort of like also dealing with like the rejection aspect of it. And like, how can this person, like what was not doing so much work not to go down the path of this is my fault. This says something about me not being a worthy partner, or like that I don't deserve this, or that I'm not good enough for him, and doing like everything in my power to not believe those things. Now what I'm really struggling with is the grief, is the just like missing him all day, every day.
Yeah.
And like that he's not in my life anymore, and that like, you know, my life still has a lot of good stuff in it, but it's...
Sure.
It's a huge loss to deal with. It's a huge adjustment, especially to go from quarantining together where we were together 24/7 to now not speaking at all. It's a lot. And so I'm trying really hard to be kind to myself and to sort of push myself to do the things that I can do and not anything more than that. So like, I get my work done, I do my schoolwork, I do my podcasting, I do YouTubing, I do my writing, I do my, you know, all of it. But then like, if my dad is like, do you want to play tennis? I'm like, no.
I think like, we've talked about this a little bit on the podcast, but like, you know, you've said that you've had like lesser breakups that have wounded you worse, and that you felt like you had prepared yourself enough, or you had become enough of your own person to be able to like handle this actually really devastating situation in like a better way. So can you speak to that?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's again that I had the coping skills and I had the self-esteem to not let it destroy me in the same way. So whereas like before, like my breakup in 2017 was very much like, oh, okay, he's leaving me, I want to die. Now it's like, he's left me, I have to figure out how to live without him. And not, you know, I had enough like safety nets to sort of catch myself from having a full breakdown.
Where
I did it.
But that's something you had to like build up over time for yourself, not knowing that you were preparing for anything, but yeah. Just like something that you had done to like grow on your own.
Yeah. I definitely was preparing for a battle I didn't think I would have to wage with
exactly.
myself.
Exactly. Yeah.
And when we were together, I always thought like, oh, okay, I've gotten to this place where I really like myself, where I feel very capable and strong, and, you know, I think if he left, you know, just because I write about relationships and I was writing this book about it. And so I had to think from like a hypothetical situation of like, you know, if he left, would I be okay? And I would think to myself, yeah, I would. But I didn't like really know or believe that. Whereas now I'm like, yes, I'm okay. I think that for me, I know that I'm okay. And that was a really big difference, is in the past I, felt, oh, I will never be okay. And with this, I was like, oh, I know I'll be okay. I just don't know if I'll be happy.
Okay, so you were writing this book, you mentioned, and now you have to change the... So can you talk about the book and then what's changing?
Yeah, so the book, I mean, it's like about dating with anxiety, OCD, and depression. And I had originally been writing the book from the point of view of, I'm a success story. I had all of these problems with relationships. I had a lot of issues with my mental health, and I was able to to figure both things out to a certain extent in order to be in a healthy long-term partnership. And so, you know, the final chapter of the book was sort of like, how do I maintain a healthy relationship? And now, you know, the last part, the last chapter of the book is, you know, how do you not give up? Because I think that's something that I'm dealing with in that, like, right now in my healing journey, I'm just, how do I get myself back on track? How do I get to a point where, like, as my therapist says, the edges of the pain are not as sharp, where, you know, the pain will always be there, but the edges won't be as, you know, as painful or as, just as sharp, you know, like where, like, I'm sure I will think of him every day for the rest of my life, but I feel like it won't necessarily be as triggering or overwhelmingly sad. And then the other part of it is then how do I get to a place where I feel ready to date again and to feel like I can do that without being super triggered by it.
Yeah, I mean, how do you lead with that? What do you say when you're dating again?
I don't know. I mean, I think it's gonna be a lot of stops and starts. I like on a whim, last weekend signed up for Hinge and then within like 24 hours was like, I don't want to do this. And so I'm sure there will be a lot of that. But I will say that my greatest fear has shifted from my fear of being alone is no longer my greatest fear. My greatest fear is settling and being with someone who I love less than I love Jake.
Yeah, but don't romanticize Jake. You know what I mean? Like, don't do that to every single person who comes, like, compare them. I was going through my desk. I found a letter that I wrote to my ex Garrett. Like, that was like, I love you so much. I'll think of you every day. I love you forever. I don't even care about that guy.
I'm not doing it so much in terms of who he was, but more how I felt in that relationship. And so in that relationship, up until the last couple of months, I guess, I felt very lucky. I felt very safe. I felt very loved. I felt compatible. I felt like, you know, so instead of like, oh, this checklist of who this person is, it's more how does this person make me feel? And I think that when I was younger, my instinct was to probably to avoid the pain by dating again pretty quickly. And I think this time around, I don't need that. I think that I'm more comfortable sitting with the pain. So it's basically just like the world opened up beneath me, but then I had like set up some safety nets so right. I didn't fall all the way down. And now I am slowly clawing my way up with a variety of footholds and handholds that I had made over the years and that I'm currently developing, you know, through reading different things and listening to different things and being kind to myself and talking to different people and my support system. And, you know, so healing comes in like so many different forms. And also sometimes you need different types of healing. So sometimes I need to cry to my mom and go over everything again. Sometimes I need to not talk about it at all and just watch TV. Sometimes I need to dance to angry music, you know? So
yeah.
I think a lot of it is just knowing that like, it's not one size fits all, that like the healing journey will have many phases and it's not like a linear journey. So you might go back to this phase. You might go 3 days without crying and then you start crying immediately.
Right.
Over the smallest thing. Yeah, I mean, it's not something I would wish on anybody, but I do think that this experience has now helped me empathize so much more with so many other people who have been through similar things.
That's what I was going to say. It brought like community.
Yeah. And it brought, you know, I think as someone who's, you know, moving more and more into like the mental health space as a, I'm obviously not a professional yet, but as like an advocate and someone who shares their own experiences, I have like some new insights. Insights I wish I did not have, but insights that I will use.
The fans often say that they wish you were their therapist, so I'm sure that's not allowed or healthy.
Yeah.
But yeah, they, you know, I think they've said that they resonate with a lot of what you're saying and that they wish that you were their therapist because you do have the lived experience.
And I also think it's really important not to feel so much shame around something like this happening, where like I hope nobody looks at me now and is like, oh, what a loser.
You know? I don't think so.
I don't think so. You know, I think it's like life happens, things happen, and I continue to do my best and be myself. Whereas I think there was a version of this where I could have maybe spun in and been like, we decided to separate, you know, but like,
or that's not the truth. Or you could have become someone on like Instagram or Twitter who's like clearly spiraling.
Yeah, I mean, I try to really be thoughtful about what content I am putting out there, and that I don't want to sugarcoat the healing experience, but I don't want to leave people feeling like, well, now I'm fucked, you know?
Yeah, because... you could have, you know, as Destiny's Child put it, you could have dissed him on the internet, but your mama taught you better than that.
Is that a lyric?
It's a lyric from Survivor.
It sucks. It just really fucking sucks. And I hate it every moment of the day. But I also know that, like, I will get through it and that it will not be as painful 6 months from now.
Right.
And that I owe myself too much to just sort of, like, give up on myself or on that part of my life. Also, just sort of embracing the uncertainty of what's next.
A fan suggested that you date Pete Davidson.
Yeah. I don't think that's something I get to decide.
Yeah, but it's wide open is what I'm saying. Like, Nathan Fielder, if you're out there, Pete Davidson, like, you know, there's tons of options.
I mean, that's part of the struggle, right, is feeling like there isn't tons of options, and that, you know, I felt so lucky to have found Jake, and it felt like a real diamond in the rough situation. And so feeling like, oh, well, that luck happened twice, well, you know, but I just have to know that who I am now is not even who I was then when we met, and and that this version of me has never dated before.
That's a really good way of looking at it.
Yeah, that's what my therapist said.
Wow. So is there anything you want to leave the people with?
Again, like, the most important relationship you have is with yourself. And so you want to, you know, you want to nurture that relationship, and you're also just so much more resilient than you think that you are. And it sucks to have to go through something like this to realize that.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, from now on, I'll know in my back pocket that I survived one of the worst things that could have happened to me. And I'm trying to use that pain to become someone that I appreciate and like even more, instead of like closing myself off from the world.
You can't avoid, I mean, life is full of pain and fear. You can't avoid it. So you just have to sit with it, which is what I've learned in that book, When Things Fall Apart, which I gave you the recommendation for, and any listener and viewer, you should get that book. It helped me to think about, it really helped me to think about how living life to avoid pain and fear is like not an option.
You know, I think it took me a long time to accept that the reason he left was because he didn't love me enough, because that was my greatest fear always, just like in my whole life. And so I was doing mental gymnastics to avoid that being the reality of the situation. But now I'm just like, he left because he didn't love me enough. And that happens.
The growth. Oh, well, thank you to the fans who have been lovely to Allison during this. Check out the podcast, JBU, Just Between Us podcast, and at JBU podcast on Instagram, because we talk about this way more in depth on the show.
I don't think we talk about it more in depth on the show.
We have. We have talked about it. Well, not. We've talked about different things, but we talk about it a lot on the show's very vulnerable.
I've never been vulnerable.
Okay.